Hi, today we are going to learn about SQL Server Management Studio. How do we connect SQL Server to Management Studio and do different database operations? First of all, we'll see what SQL Server is configured. So when you're logged on to the Max application, the first thing you see here is it says the database server. Which is the server machine and what instance is the software connected to? That is connected to Max 2012 and it says SQL Server 2012 Service Pack 1, 64-bit is the system. And this is the server machine, otherwise it will show it as a client machine or whatever it is. The 64-bit is not of the server, it's of the current system. And this SQL server is belonging to the database server. Okay. So if you are connected on a client PC, still the database server will remain same, just for our identification where this database is pointed to, which system among the network. And how do we configure database? Under options, we have this option to configure database. Certain options are available here also where we are mentioning attach and detach. We have certain options for syncing the database. All these are available in the backend also through SQL Server Management Studio. We can use certain commands and execute all this. So in case if the application is running, we usually try doing it here. In case if it's not working through this way, then we use Management Studio. So even that is equally important. How do you download the Management Studio? Management Studio will not get installed with the application by default. So you'll have to go to the website and maxerp.com. Under support you'll find downloads. In that you'll have the link for SQL Server Management Studio specifically. So you can click and download the Management Studio. While installing and downloading Management Studio, you have to make sure that you're downloading the correct version of Management Studio. 2008 or 12, whichever it is. Make sure it is 64-bit or 32-bit as per the system configuration. Under My Computer Properties, you'll find whether the system is 32-bit or 64-bit, and based on that you can download the correct edition and install. So how do we verify this at the back end? So once we go to SQL Server, you find this SQL Server Management Studio. So after installing, you'll find this option in your system. Under SQL Server Management Studio, you will find a server name. So there are multiple server names mentioned here. I have 2016 installed in my system. I have Max 2008, which is SQL 2008 basically. That is also in Management Studio. We can connect any version of SQL Server. Even being in SQL version 2012, the Management Studio is of 2012, I can still connect to 2008 or 2016 instance and do relevant database operations. So there are certain options here like database type. We are just going with database engine, and then we have an option for SQL Server where which instance we are connecting to. So I'm just connecting to Max 2012, which is what we have seen in the application at the beginning. Now then we have an option for authentication mode. What do you mean by authentication mode? SQL Server authentication and Windows authentication. These are two typical authentication available for logging into SQL Server, both from the application side also as well as on the database side also. From application side, we are using SQL Server authentication only. Why? Windows authentication is possible to log in only in the same system where the SQL Server is installed. Using Windows authentication, you cannot use the Management Studio or connect to an instance from a client PC. Using SQL Server authentication, you can connect it from any PC which is connected over the network. So for application side, we are using SQL Server authentication. And for Management Studio, if you want, you can use SQL Server authentication also if you know the password. And if you do not know the password, you can directly click Windows authentication and click connect. You should be on the admin login on the system, then only it will connect. So as per the Windows authority, it will still login, allow you to log into the instance. There, in case if you forgot your password or there's some corruption that has happened and you are not able to log in through SQL authentication, then you can use Windows authentication and log in and change the passwords. Nothing but two modes basically. Windows authentication will require you to be on the admin login on the Windows, then only it will allow you to log in. So by default, we generally avoid this Windows authentication. We use only a single method. Once in a while, if there is a password, we do not know the password or we need to reset the password, then in that scenario, we go to Windows authentication and change the SQL Server instance password and again come back to SQL Server authentication. In SQL Server authentication, the default username is SA. SA is nothing but system administrator. Okay, that should be in small letters. While we install SQL Server, this will be a default user that gets created. This is the password which we give while installing the SQL Server. By default, our application has a standard password which gets installed automatically. But in case if you even have a custom password, then you need to mention this password here, and the same password will be even mentioned while database configuration or application. So using with this username and password, it logs into the database. So here we have mentioned the password, and we click remember password so that every time we do not have to mention this. So once we click connect, it will bring all these databases options. It is showing you the version here. 11.0 is nothing but version 2012. And another database, you will find all the connected databases. There's one database 27, Oswal, and there's one more database saying MaxEnt. The MaxEnt is only coming here. The other one is not coming here. Why? The other one is not belonging to MaxERP. It's some other application database. Software will automatically recognize whichever are the data of application, those will be listed. Others will not be listed. Now, how does the application recognize that? You have this plus sign everywhere. So in the plus sign, you can find out different options available under a database. This is one single database, and under that you have certain categories here. So we'll understand the basics of the database here. Here we are using the database tables. Tables are nothing but a set of Excel sheets. For your layman term, there'll be multiple Excel sheets. Each of this database table is an Excel sheet. So we have so many tables in our MaxERP database. So many things. All these are storing different information. Like all the customer addresses are stored here, bank details are stored here, account contacts are stored here, and then account groups are stored here. Each table will again have a structure. Internally, when you just open this table, it will show you some information. What application does is, it combines all this information, gives the meaningful information on the software. At the back end, it is storing raw information connected with different, there's some certain ID fields which are connecting each and every table. Okay, so this table is only storing address information for different contacts in the software. It's like an Excel sheet, row and columns. You can have n number of rows, n number of columns. So likewise, multiple Excel sheets are working together, combinedly are making a database. When you see a stock report or when you see some party's ledger, it is bringing information from different tables and furnishing that information on the screen so that it's easy for the user to read. And from the screen, other print operations and Excel and export to PDF, emailing, all that goes on. But at the back end, all the data are stored like this in a raw format. So we have tables. There are certain tables is finally all the data will be stored within the table only. We'll not go much into detail of the other options because we are not using it much, and neither it's relevant for you to learn in that detail unless we are going for database administration options. So this is how all the tables will be stored, and as per the tables, the software will automatically recognize that these all tables are belonging to MaxERP. So it will show the books in the MaxERP listing. After this, in case if you want to change the password for SQL Server, then you can just go to security, you have logins. Under logins you find SA. So once you double click this SA or right click and go to properties, it will show you the password information. So I don't want a password policy, and I can just type in the new password here and click OK. I'll have to type the new password twice and click OK. Then the password will get reset. Once we change the password here, even the application will show the database connectivity failure screen, and again we'll click next and it will list us all the database server instances. We'll select the same instance, Max 2012, and type the new password there in the application also, and then only it will get connected, otherwise it will fail. So this is how we change the SQL Server password. What else do we have in Management Studio? There are certain SQL commands that we pass in SQL Server. Those commands are the database commands basically. All these database commands can be, we have option to physically do it also, as well as we can do it through a command also, through SQL Server commands. Now first of all, once we right click here, we have certain options saying new query, start, stop, restart. These are all the service restart. Basically this is the instance is a service, Dell PC hyphen Max 2012 is a service running back in the background of the Windows. So we can even control the service from here, where if we give stop, the database connection will get stopped. I mean, you won't, none of the application will be able to access this database. And we have option to stop, pause and restart here. Apart from that, we can disconnect this instance if we don't want. Disconnect means only from the management studio. The service is still running at the background of the Windows. We can reconnect it again and see other options. We can restart the services from here and we can type in new query. What do you mean by new query? New query, query window is something where we can type certain commands and get the relevant information. For example, from this table, from this database, I want something to be accessed. So I can just select max ENT here. I can give select star from account. These are the tables, basically the tables that we saw here. So once I give here as a command and I click execute, so I'm able to find all the information here. Here I can even type something like, let's say area ID is 235. So where area ID, the field names are also coming, equal to 235, and I click execute. So wherever there's area ID 235, that is those data are being displayed. These are similar commands which we use in the application front end on the coding part. Through which, when we filter certain area or when we filter certain city, we get that relevant information only. This is a basic SQL language that we are using. The select star command would be the generic one which we will be using. We'll have a certain, other commands also that we'll learn later. Currently, we'll learn few other things like how do you backup and restore. So this is a query window. In the query window, we can just select the table database in which we are going to execute the command, and once we select the database, we can type the command here and click show or click execute basically. I can even type here like I just want address 1, comma address 2. If I just need 2 information only, then I can just type 2 information, I get only those details. Okay, we'll come back to this on later point. Other database operations that we have here is we can just right click the database and go to properties. Under properties, I have general tab. I can see the files that are being used, from which folder it is coming. So it is in D drive max ERP data folder. The physical file is there. See, each database has 2 files. The main primary MDF file and a log file. Log file is a temporary file which is used for operations. So when we fetch any report in the application, the data is being passed through the log file. So log is a temporary file which will keep expanding on its own and it will even keep reducing on its own. Then we have other options here where there are certain options available here. By default, all the settings are correct, but once in a while we might find chances where database goes into a read-only mode. To bring it out of read-only mode, you'll have to make it false. If it's true, you'll have to make it false. Database read only. If you make it true, the database will be in read only mode. None of the application or user through any command will be able to write anything in the database or update anything in the database. When it is false, user are allowed to even read or write or delete whatever is required. Same way, there's an encryption option also available. We are not using this option in our application, but this option is also useful where entire data will remain encrypted. User will not be able to read the data through this physical file also. That is also a possibility. And then we have access, restricted access. If the database goes to single user mode, then we have 3 options here: restricted user, single user, and multi user. By default, the application database will be in multi user mode. What do you mean by multi user mode? More than one user can access the database parallelly, simultaneously. Okay. Now, if Max application is if it's in single user mode, assuming this particular data, if we set it in single user mode, we are accessing this database through Management Studio. Only one thread or one request or one command can handle the database at a time. So when we are accessing through Management Studio, our application there will not be able to access the data. If we are accessing through the application, the Management Studio, we might not be able to access the database because it will be in single user mode. Single user means one thread accessing the database, or one service, one command, one application is taking over one database. Multi-user means parallelly even application can access, client system can access, hundreds of users can access through the SQL service. So if it's in single user mode, you'll have to change to multi-user mode. This is what it should be. So by default, database read only should be false, and it should be restrict access should be multi-user. Other than this, we are using Management Studio to even backup and restore. In case if you want to do a backup, restore, attach and detach. First we'll learn about attach detach. How do we attach and detach? There's an option here saying detach database, take offline. We have option to shrink the files also. Shrink is nothing but it will reduce the file size, the database size and the log file. We can even give shrink command. Shrink command will just reduce it 2%. The database is already 11 MB, and once we give OK, it will reduce it by 2%. Basically, all this temporary memory which is there in the database will get emptied. Basically, data will get size will get reduced, and even this file will have 1% extra. So even this, see, for this small database is all OK. When the database volume is high and the size is in GBs, that time when we give the shrink command, it will make big impact. If the database is for 700 MB, it might bring it to 600, 500 MB, depending on this. But we are generally not supposed to do this shrink. Unless it's very necessary for us, we are not doing this shrink. There are chances where it might harm the database itself. Because that sometimes the temporary memory is required for the speed optimization on the application front. All the data flow in that temporary space and then it will display faster. In case if we don't follow this, then again, the first time it will take time to load all the data in the temporary database, it will expand the log file and then to fetch the data, so that might impact the application performance. Then we will learn about detach and attach. Why do we detach? In case if I want to shift the data from this server to some other server, or from this instance of SQL server to some other instance of SQL server, then I will have to detach. What happens after detach? Basically, the service is still running. If I have 5 databases here, and I just want to disturb only one, I want to copy this or shift this, then I can just specifically go here and click detach. Once detach option is there, it will show you certain options here saying drop existing connections. You can tick this and click OK. It says two active connections. You click here also, it will show you. Okay, there are two active connections. One is the Management Studio, one the application at the back end. So once I click drop connections and click OK, it will disconnect all the connections from behind and the database is detached. It's no more in the SQL server. When you go to the application and you just press F5 and refresh, the data is no more displayed here. Second option is attach. Once we click attach, it will ask you from where do you want to attach this data. I can just select saying Max Enterprises. It will show both LDF and MDF, the log file and the main database file. So there's an option to remove here. Once we click this log file, it shows an option remove. In case if we remove the log file here, there are sometimes chances where the log gets corrupted. So this could be one of the solution for that, where if I remove the log, the SQL Management Studio will recreate a new log file for that particular database. We cannot remove the main MDF file. Once we come here, see that it goes disabled. And once I select this log, there's an option to remove. Once I remove the log and I click OK, the Management Studio itself will create a new log for this MDF file. In case if the log is corrupted or if it's missing, then this is one way of creating or regenerating a new log file. Log file is a temporary file, it's not having all the data, but it should be there along with the database. Both together are a single database. So once I click here and click OK, the database got attached again. So it is attached here, and I press F5 or refresh here, it is showing me the book again. Clear? Now a couple of more options are available where sometimes when you try to attach, it might show access denied or it's being used by some other process. When it says it's being used by some other process, understand that it might be connected to some other SQL server instances. Since my system has multiple instances, there are chances where some database is connected to 2008. When I try to attach the same data to 2012, it will not connect because it's already connected with 2008. It is connected there, it's in physically. Once the file is connected, you cannot copy or delete or rename that database file from the physical Windows folder also. You cannot, from the Explorer, you cannot delete or copy the files, the SQL Server database files. So when it is connected to some other instance also, it's in it's only read and write access only with that particular instance. Other instances cannot read and write that particular database. So in that case, you might have to stop that service or detach the database from that instance and then attach it here. When you detach something from 2008 and attach it to 2012, it can never be reattached to 2008 because the database itself will get upgraded, the version. So once it is connected to 2012, it cannot be reconnected to 2008. In 2012, it can be connected to local DB also. In case if it's connected to 2016, again it cannot be connected to 2012 as well as 2008. Okay. So as the database version increases, it cannot be reconnected to the old database instances, old version instances basically. Clear here? Detach attach is also clear. Next option we'll learn is how to backup and restore manually from SQL Server. So we can even rename the database here. Once we click rename here, only the physical name here in the SQL Server will get renamed. But the database file which is available in the Windows folder will not get renamed. The physical file name will remain same. The internal file name of SQL database will get changed. So this option also we are not using, because in our application the physical file name and the database file name should be same. Then only it will be able to read correctly. So we are not even doing anything in this part, so by default everything will work as desired for the application. If you click delete here, what happens? The database will get deleted from here also, and the physical file will also get deleted. So Management Studio, the user whoever has the access to Management Studio has to handle it professionally and properly. If unnecessarily some wrong commands are executed, then the chances of losing the data are there. Okay. So we have seen the properties option, we will now see backup and restore. Shrink option also we have seen, detach attach also we have seen. Take offline is one option which will again keep the database attached, but it will be in offline mode, only accessible via Management Studio. It won't be accessible from any other application outside. So if we give this offline mode, it is only accessible through the Management Studio where we can do some backend operation commands. If there are 20-25 users accessing the database and we need to execute something on the backend, we can click that take offline, run the command certain commands using Management Studio, and then till that time none of the other users will be able to access, and then again make it online. That's the second option I will bring online. Okay. Now how do we backup and restore? Once we click backup, so it says which data you want to backup, what type of backup do you want, full backup or differential backup. See, in our application by default we are using full backup option only. There's a local backup engine which is running at the backend. Okay, it's not running in the system, but once you find that local backup engine, that will keep taking the differential backups. What do you mean by full backup and differential backup? Differential backup is a backup which will keep a track of the last backup date time and will take backup only from that till the current point of date and time. Okay. Only a part of backup will come, not the complete data. Full backup means right from the day one till now, all the data's complete database will get backed up. Differential backup, it will keep a track of time. And only that difference, if let's say last differential backup was today morning, and last 3 hours if there's no backup, then when you give the differential backup command, only the 3 hours backup will come. So from the last backup point of today's morning before 3 hours, for the next 3 hours till the current point of time, the backup will happen. And after 1 hour when you again give a differential backup, only for that 1 hour backup data will get backed up. So it will create multiple set of files, and all this file combined will be a complete backup. What is the advantage about differential and full backup? Full backup will take a lot of time and a lot of memory and system resources, because the entire data needs to be backed up every time. When we close the application, auto backup takes full backup. And full backup is being executed every time when you close the application. When the database size is small, it's okay. If the database size is big, it will take a lot of time. Whereas differential backup is also happening through the application under the folder local backups, where date wise it will take first backup as a full backup automatically at the backend, user will not even interfere anywhere on the screen. And after that, every 1 hour it will keep taking the differential backups. So if at a particular point if the data is lost or something, then we can have full backup of that day from the morning, and then we can find it, okay, till 12 everything was correct, after 12 something went wrong. Up to 12 we can restore all those backups. Understood? Okay, let's assume we'll consider full backup only. We are not going in detail for differential backup. We have this option in the application itself. Under application, when you find differential backup, we have an option here where you can normal full backup and full restore. This is options is available. We even have cloud backup restore options, but this is generally cloud backup is also a full backup and restore only. Complete data will get backed up on the cloud, complete data will get restored. Here also physically we will take full backup in a pen drive or some other drive and we can restore the full backup. Differential backup keep happening automatically at the background for every 1 hour, and we have an option here in the database saying restore differential backups. So once you click this, it will ask you for a folder where the backup is, and you will find that local backups folder in your application. Under local backups you will find date wise folders. You select a particular date and it will show you all the backups available right from the first. It will have the file names like 000, that is the full backup, then 001, 002, every 1 hour one file will keep getting generated. So you can choose up to what you want to restore. If there are 10 files, 001, 002, 003, so likewise you can just select one particular. Yes, I'll show you an example for restore. Okay, now it's come. So it says choose the directory. So this is a local backup directory. Under that I can select one folder. I can select one particular folder. In this all the database will be available, whichever have been backed up. Okay, there's nothing available in this. We already have a FAQ on this. Under 14 we have a lot of backups. So once you select this folder, it will show you all the database that are available. So when you select max, and all the database backups will keep happening. Under max enterprises, how many backups do we have? So we have first backup of full 000, then 1, 2, 3, 4, every 1 hour one backup will get created. Assuming we found something went wrong at this time, and this point of time it was everything correct, you can see the backup date time on the back end in the folder itself. And you can select, once we select up to 4 and click restore, from the full till that date, fourth backup, it will get restored. The fifth one will be ignored. From fourth onwards, whatever changes have been done, that we will have to do redo in the software. Able to understand the difference? If I just give only this full backup means, till that day morning, whatever was the backup, that will get restored. After that, whatever changes they have done in that day will not be restored. For this, the alternate option is having last backup restored of the yesterday's day's auto backup folder also. From the main auto backups also, you can restore the complete data for the previous day. And yes, we'll understand the backup restore command through SQL Server now. So we'll take a full backup. Under backup, it says where do you want to take a backup under disk, and it says but what folder you have to take. So I can just click remove and I can click my own. So by default, we'll take backup in SQL Server only. But I'll just give a backup in. Yes, in the C drive, I can just give a file name saying maxent.bak. Make sure you give the extension .bak, where the file extension for the backup should be this. And once I click OK, it says access is denied, so C drive access is not available. Maybe I'll just give on D drive. I give OK. So the backup is done. This file will not be a compressed file, it will be a complete file. You see your D drive here, there will be this maxent, it's a complete file. Okay. So when you go to D drive, you will find this maxent file, which is a complete backup, which has happened. Since the database which we are seeing is very small, the same database complete size will come here. It is not a compressed backup, it's a complete backup. So now if you want to transfer it to some other media, we can right click and compress it and copy it whichever drive as we want. And same way we can even restore the same backup from SQL Server Management Studio. How do we restore? So we right click a particular database, go to task and click restore, and we get restore database. Once we click restore here, it is showing the differential backup option or the full backup that has been taken last. I can just select from a device. From where do you want to restore? So I can just select a particular the folder D drive, and I can select this file max.ent and click OK. Again OK. So once I click OK, it shows that the last backup taken, date, time, the complete information which what time it was taken, and restore this one. While restoring, I even have to go to files option and verify that it is getting restored in the correct folder where I want. By default it will be in SQL Server. If the database is not available, since I right clicked here, it's okay on the existing database. So it is taking to the existing database path. If we do not have the database itself, then also there's an option where we can restore this backup and create a new database generated in the SQL Server. So by default it will go to the SQL Server default folder, C drive, program files, SQL Server. We will have to just select the directory or click relocate. Click this and relocate the new folder. See, this is the default directory for this instance. So we'll have to select which folder we want to restore it to. This will be required. This many times this will not be auto available. So we'll just select our max.erp folder. Give OK. Same would be applicable for log file also. So this option might be a little different in SQL Management Studio 2008. There you might have to directly type here or select the path here. This might option, I mean, there are chances where it might be a little different in different versions of Management Studio. But make sure you give the correct path here. So it says original file. If it is from some other system, F drive, then it will show you F drive max ERP data. In our system, in the system where it is getting restored, in what folder it should get restored, and what should be the file name also. So even the file name is coming here. So if you want to change any file name here, you can even change the file name. So it will get restored as a different file name. If you change the file name here as 1718 or XYZ, it will get in that file name. Under third options, you have to tick this overwrite with replace and close existing connections to the destination database. So any other application connected to this database will get closed, the connections will get terminated, and you are replacing or overwriting the existing database. If you don't tick this option, then there are chances where it says that it cannot restore because it doesn't have the overwrite access. If you don't tick this, means it will show that a database is in use, cannot be restored. So we are forcefully closing all the connections and we are overwriting the existing database. So when we execute the same command from our software, this is the same thing happens. It closes all the connection and overwrites the physical database. So once we click OK here, the restore has happened. Now how do you find restore has happened or not? Let's take a simple example. I'll go to the application. We have taken a backup with. What does restore do? It will restore the complete database. So we can delete one transaction and restore it again and see if the transaction exists. So I just click previous and I delete this particular command. See, bill number 10 for Pothys is 31. Okay. So it's a receipt registered against it. So I'll delete this receipt also. And I'll delete this bill also. So we are at bill number 10 has been deleted. And we'll just go back, close here. Come back to SQL Server Studio. There are chances where we can even delete the complete data also. We'll see this and restore. The database itself, assuming it's not available in the system, I'm just deleting this database. Max.ent 1718 is our database file name. So it has deleted the database itself. Now once we come to the application, press refresh F5 here, database is not available. How do we restore when the database itself is not available? So you just right click the database and there's an option saying restore database. Here we'll select the device, we'll select the file saying add. D-type, maxent, give OK, go to files, so it is restoring to the same path, so path and the database file name has come correctly from the as per the backup. So we want to restore in the same path, so no changes here. And third option, since nothing is there, I can still give OK. The close connection is not available because the database itself is not there in the list. If the physical file is there, then it will overwrite that same file. Now once we have restored, and we see here, and we select bill number 10 for Pothis should be there. So that Pothis bill is still available. Okay, so data backup restore. Backup restore can happen. Backup you can do, take in any drive. Restore can happen even if the database is not physically available. Okay, the same is possible through our application also, and we are seeing the example using the Management Studio. So I think most of the operations from Management Studio are covered. Apart from this, there are commands for executing a suspect mode. For example, if we want to recover the database, there are chances when sometimes database gets corrupted, and if we want to restore that or recover that. So in our application itself, we have an option here where you can go to database and click repair all databases, and it will automatically try recovering or repairing the database. By default, these are the commands which are being passed in SQL Server, and it will get copied to your clipboard automatically. So if you find it getting repaired automatically from the application, well and good. If you are not able to repair it from the application, then you can even paste those commands in the Management Studio. So see, it is showing some error that it's not able to log into this particular database. Restore will take all the data available in your data folder. It will try repairing all the databases available in your data folder. Anyways, we'll just paste one command here and we can just see or change the data file name. This command is also available in our FAQ. As well as through this repair also, you can take one sample command, paste in the Management Studio and replace with so once we have done this, we can execute individual command or we can just press F5 and also execute the entire thing together. Either you in the Management Studio, once we select this one row or particular command, only this command gets executed. If you do not select anything, entire thing gets executed. If I don't select anything and I press execute here, entire thing will get executed. So we'll see which command is okay. The second command is done. The third command, it is setting the database to single user mode. What we have seen in the database file properties, this is what the application does here. You might have to close the application because it's in use, so there might be chances where it might throw error, the application is in use. So executing, and the fourth command, we can actually execute all the commands together itself, but here just for our learning purpose, I'm executing one command at a time. If there are any corruptions in the database, it will be showing you something, some messages in the red color. If there's a database corruption, this will at least repair it, but there are chances where we might lose some data from it. Generally it repairs, but if the database is corrupted and is critical, if the file itself has got damaged through some bad sectors in the hard disk, then there are chances where the complete data might not get recovered or we might lose some data from it. Most of the times this is a very rare scenario where we face this kind of issue. But most of the time if the database, anything wrong has happened with this command itself, it gets repaired. Next we'll learn how to connect local DB also. We can use Management Studio to connect local DB instances. What do you mean by local DB instances? The single user lightweight database that we have. It has all the capabilities of SQL Server, but the installation file is also small and it can be accessed only by a single user. To connect to a LocalDB, first we'll see what all LocalDB instances are available. To find out LocalDB instances, you just have to pass a command saying SQL LocalDB space info. Once you give this, it will show you all the LocalDB instances that are created in the system. So we have some MSMaster, MSLocalDB and Max instance. So if we want to execute certain commands to a LocalDB database, then how do we connect? Because LocalDB connections will not be shown in this. Once we connect here, only the SQL Server services and the instances which are installed will be listed here. How do we connect to LocalDB? To connect to a LocalDB, you always have to use Windows authentication only, because there's no SQL authentication for LocalDB. And second thing you will have to use is, you'll have to use this command saying LocalDB, all small. It's a normal bracket, LocalDB slash the instance name. We had this multiple instance name which we saw on the command prompt. So we select this and it will connect to that LocalDB instance. If there are any data connected to that instance, those will be listed here. The instances are not running as a background Windows service, so we don't have anything about it. But LocalDB is applicable only from SQL Server 2012 onwards. And this instance I've connected, LocalDB Max instance, and once I go to databases, it says nothing is available. If we have any databases attached here, attach, detach, backup, restore, all this, and this command execution, everything can work as such the same way in LocalDB also. Only thing is you should be connected to the correct instance. So here we just saw how to see the different instances of LocalDB available on that particular system, and then how do we connect to a LocalDB instance using Windows authentication only. There's no SQL authentication for LocalDB. There is other command for LocalDB where now there are so many instances created. By default, when we install SQL Server LocalDB, and once you execute this command, SQL LocalDB space info, you should find this single one, v11.0. This will get created by default, because v11 is SQL Server 2012, the version 11. If this is resulting v11, then you can understand that LocalDB is installed. Apart from this, you will require .NET Framework 4.5 for the software connectivity. LocalDB is installed, software is not connecting, make sure you have installed .NET Framework 4.5 correctly or restart the system once. Even after LocalDB, sometimes you will not, once you execute this command, you will find bad command or bad command error. If SQL LocalDB is installed, that also you have to make sure 32-bit and 64-bit as per the system. You have to install that version only. If you find bad command, restart the system once. Well, it might not get registered in system's memory immediately. Once you restart, it will come. So then most of the times we have found that after installing, it's not coming, and the support team is taking time to, unnecessary time for understanding why it's not getting connected. So once you restart, it will immediately get connected. So other commands of SQL Server LocalDB are, I can stop the services here also. SQL LocalDB space, I can give stop. And then double quote. Let's say I want to delete all this, max 44436. I cannot delete unless I stop. These all are running LocalDB instances at the background. Oh, sorry, 36. So these are all running services of LocalDB at the background. If I want to remove all these ones which are unnecessary, then I will have to stop first. So it says LocalDB is a stop, and then I have to use a delete command. So this is deleted. Next I can again give stop for the other one. 54850. And then I can click delete for the same. Then I have, so likewise I can do for all. 65905. If I directly execute delete, it says cannot be it is deleted. Since it's not running, it is deleted. So you can even directly delete also. Yes, master. If it's running, it will show you an error. Then you'll have to stop it first. Once it is stopped, you cannot even connect through Management Studio. Neither you can connect from the application. How do you connect it from the application under database configuration? You have to select that particular local DB instance name and select local DB also, use local DB. There's no password involved here. In case, how do you start it again? So let's say I even stop this one. Max instance. So this is stopped. Now if I refresh here or I do anything here, the chances it will throw error or it will not get connected again. It will keep reading. It is auto started. Now once I give info, it says only two instances are available. Once we connect from Management Studio, it auto starts the instancing. How do you create a new instance? All these names were there. How do I create? Let's say I want to create XYZ. How do I create it? Okay. Local DB space create is option is available. But when we are at client space, we are never using this command prompt. How do we create them? Not everyone knows also. But we are still configuring local DB on a regular basis. Now we don't reinstall also. By reinstallation, none of the instance gets created. By default, when we install, only this gets created, v11.0. So under our database configuration, when we go to, when we select use local DB and click finish, it will automatically search at the backend if that instance is available. If it's not available, it will automatically create. So there, if we give some new name, it will automatically create that new name. Understood? No, not while installing. Under our application, now let's say there's only two instances available, max instance and v11. When we go to our max ERP application, okay, we have closed the application. So when we go to options, database, configuration, since it's a multi-user license, that local DB option itself is not coming. That will come only for single user ones. But once we tick that, this both username and password gets disabled and you get a name saying local DB slash max instance or max some random numbers. When you change that to anything else, even if random number is there and you change to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and you click finish, that instance it will automatically search if it's there. If it's not there, it will create. No, this is the one which creates. Whatever name that you give here, that gets created and that is getting linked with the application by default. There's one more option saying refresh local DB instance, which will be available at the bottom once local DB is enabled. What do you mean by that option? Refresh local DB is, even in local DB there are chances where the database is connected with some other local DB instance. It will not fetch it here. Sometimes if you're not able to connect or you're not able to see the databases in front of your screen, basically it is being read by some other instance and it cannot be read by this. Two instances cannot read the same database physical file. Local DB, since it's a file based reading concept, it reads and writes the file directly. Only one command or one thread at the back end of local DB instance will be taking control of one database. So in that scenario, once we click refresh databases, it will actually delete all the database of local DB and it will create the new one, and then it will attach the database to the new one. Once in a while we even use that. Very rarely we find that. If it's not being read, then once we click refresh instance, delete all the instances of local DB, create a new one which is mentioned here in the server name, and they attach the database to that, and then it will start displaying. Clear? I think local DB we have covered up, and now we'll learn about SQL Server Configuration Manager, where we can restart or enable certain settings through which the client systems will connect. So in Windows 10 and Windows 8, we will have to, you might not find the SQL Server configuration directly coming in your start menu. So you can start it using a command SQL Server Manager. 10 is for Windows 8, and I mean 10 is for Windows SQL Server 2008, and 11 is for SQL Server 2012. Since we have 2012 installed, once we type SQL Server Manager 11.msc, you find this command. You'll have to use 10 years for SQL Server 2008. This option is directly coming in start menu in Windows 7 and all, but Windows 8.1 onwards and Windows 10, this is not directly visible on the start menus. So you have to open it through the command. In command, we can see all the SQL instances which are running in the background. SQL Server 2008, 12, 16 one is not coming here because it's not able to read 16. For 16, we have the next set of separate configuration manager will be available. So 2008, we have MS SQL Server is the default instance, and Max 2008, which we have additionally configured. So this is for that, and for 2012, we have Max 2012 and Max 2016 ENT, which is being displayed here. So once we click any of the service, it says shared memory, name, pipes, and TCP/IP. By default, once we install SQL Server from the software, when it installs Max 2008, everything will be enabled by default. But when we configure our own instance separately, then this is not configured, this remains disabled. When this are disabled, only your server machine can access the data, the client system will never be able to connect with the database. For the client system to connect to the database, this has to be enabled. Once we enable, it says you have to restart the service. Again, even this has to be enabled, and it will still say you'll have to restart the service. So Max 2012 has to be restarted. Now services, what are database services we have? SQL Browser, SQL Agent, and Max 2012 is available. So I can just right click and restart the service from here, whichever particular instance which I'm looking at. So I can restart that particular instance service from here. Alternatively, I can even find all the services under Windows. So once the service is restarted, now you should be able to connect from the client system. Even for our mobile and web app connectivity to the system, you require this to be enabled, and there are certain additional settings available. We'll have a separate video on those. You can even start the service from services.msc, and you can find the same names here. Under services.msc, if you just type SQL, you find SQL 2008, 2012, 2016, and their agents and a browser service. So even browser should be running, and browser is required for mobile and web access connectivity by default, and for Mac older version also browser is required. By default it is on only, but in case make sure even browser remains on better. And this is available here where we have just restarted this. If the service is stopped, the databases and the physical file can be copied, can be deleted, and software will not be able to access the data. It will show database connected failure. So at times when you find database connected failure on Windows start itself, or customer calls up saying there's no, it shows the database connected failure message, then you have to, first thing you have to verify is whether the service is running or not. That particular database instance service is running or not. In services.msc, you can just check this out. If it's running, then okay. If it's not running, you can go to properties and you can see the startup type automatic, manual, disabled. Make sure it is not disabled or it's not in manual. If it's manual, means you have to restart it manually every time. Automatic means it will start with the Windows itself immediately. And there's one more option saying automatic delayed start. What do you mean by this? After the Windows services are all started, then at a later point this will be called. There are chances where at times the main automatic service doesn't start with Windows automatically. And user, while using the application, he may be starting the Windows, he will double click Max and finds the database connected to failure. Sometimes there are chances where it's not working. So we can even try this as a solution where automatic delayed is selected and we click OK, and then when we restart the system, we ask customer to wait for 2 minutes after the Windows is started and then start the application, so that all the services in the background are running correctly. By default it's automatic only and it works fine. Sometimes automatic delayed can even be a solution to the issues of the customers for service not being started. Other than this, there are chances where the background SQL Server files itself are corrupted. The main database service also has certain database inside, through which it is taking care, or it is storing that in that particular instance how many databases are attached. Finally, the list of databases which we are seeing in SQL Server Management Studio, the list is also being managed by SQL Server somewhere, right? So if that master database itself is corrupted, where do you find that master? See, when you connect to an SQL Server instance, you find something called, when I just right click here and click new, so you find something called master here. These are the system database. Master is the system database, model, MSDB and TempDB. This, all these four are system database. 21.7 Oswald is ours, MaxEnt is ours. Remaining are the system database. System databases are required for the SQL Server itself. It keeps some records inside through which it is understanding what password has been set, how many databases are attached in this instance, how many differential backups have been taken. It keeps its own internal log in that. But if that database itself is corrupted, then there are chances where the service will not start, will throw some error message saying MSDB log not found or MasterDB not found. It might show some error. To start the service after that, you need not uninstall SQL Server and install it again completely. You can just go to C drive program files, the main management studio program, C drive program files, Microsoft SQL Server folder. Under SQL Server, you'll find version 11 is there, version 10.5, 2008 is available, and the 10.52 instances were there. As per the instances, it is showing you the folders also. So under 11, just a minute. So for SQL Server 2012, 64 bit, you might find the data for SQL Server in program files folder. Under program files, we have MAX 2012, MAX 2016 ENT, all the instances available here. So we just select MAX 2012, we find MS SQL folder. Under that we find template data. What is this template data? Template data is having the initial files which are installed or which are created while SQL Server instance installation. This particular MAX 2012 when we installed, the initial datas were available here. So here we have master, model, MSDB and TempDB. All these four we found there in the management studio, the system databases. So in case there are chances if something is corrupted, most of the times the master data you just have to copy from here, and that from that particular instance template data folder, you have to go to data folder and overwrite it. But that service needs to be stopped, then only it will allow you to overwrite. Since the server itself is not starting, obviously it will remain stopped. During that time you'll have to overwrite this master log and master MDF. Okay. Even after that, if it's not working, then the second option would be MSDB. These two files will go step by step, and the third option generally would be TempDB maximum. First, generally the master itself will get the service started. In case even after that, if it's not working, then you have to go to MSDB and copy that MSDB from template data folder. This MSDB data and log file, copy it from here and paste in the data folder. Overwrite. After that, try starting the service again. Even after that, if it's not working, TempDB would be the third option. But once you do this, then the service will definitely start most of the times. Unless something else is corrupted, then that's a different thing. But if the SQL service have got corrupted due to some power failure or something, then the chances are there where these data are corrupted and you are overwriting this and it gets repaired. What you have to do is find the correct folder of SQL Server for that particular instance. Under that, you find the data template data folder, which will have the default files, default system database file, which are blank. You have to copy those files and paste in the data folder, override it, and then start the service in services.mac. If it's successful, then you can start connecting with the application. Chances are you might not find the database in the list, because since the default databases have been replaced, SQL Server will not have a track of what database were connected, what database were attached. So you might require to attach the databases again. Okay. Able to follow? Any doubts here? How did you find this folder? Either if it's a 32-bit installation of SQL Server, you'll find in program files x86, If it's a 64-bit installation of SQL Server, you'll directly find in program files itself. Under program files, you'll have SQL Server folder. Under SQL Server folder, you'll have to go to the folder which is specific for that particular instance. Under that, you'll have template data folder from which you'll have to copy either master.log. If the message is clearly indicating MSDB issue only, then only copy MSDB, don't copy master. If you're not aware what error it is, then you can try master, copy master MDF and log file from here and paste in the data folder of that same instance and overwrite it. Then try restarting the service. If it's working, okay. If it's not working, then second option would be MSDB. Try again. If it's not working, third option would be TempDB. After all these three, it should definitely work. And after this, you might even have to attach the SQL Server databases. There are chances where the database attached database list might not be available in the SQL Server, so you'll have to reattach the databases. So as we have seen, the SQL Server Configuration Manager, in this, if the database sometime is not connecting from the client system, then what all we do? First thing we will try is we'll run this SQL Server Firewall BAT. This file will generally be available in client system, or we might have to download it from our FAQ and configure it in, download in the customer system and right click and run as administrator. So this will open the SQL Server port in the firewall, and after that you try connecting from the client system again. It should work. If it's not working, the second option is make sure that all these are enabled. They should even be done before the firewall BAT. First of all, is all this option should be enabled and your service should be restarted. Then try connecting. Doesn't work, use the IP name, the system's IP instead of server name. Here we have Dell PC/Max 2012. We will have to use IP name of the system, saying 192.168.0.10/Max 2012. Use that as the server name. Try connecting in the server first, and successful connection should be there, and then try with the client. Even that should work. If that step is also not working, third step is you'll have to enable the SQL Server setting in the firewall by downloading this file. And after this, try connecting to client system again. That should work. Even if this doesn't work, the fourth option is you right click this TCP IP, go to properties. This option is anyhow required here. This option will even be required for our mobile app connectivity. So you go to properties and you go to IP address. And the last thing, you just remove TCP IP port, and the dynamic port you just mention as anything, like we are using this one, 65432. This is the standard thing which we are trying to use. And click OK. Once we click OK, we'll have to restart the service again. So we go to services and right click SQL Server 2012 and restart. We can use this along with the IP address also. So once we restart this, how do we configure this in the application also, we'll see. The system IP is 192.168.1.24. So the service is restarted. You go to the Max application, go to options, configuration, database configuration, click next. How do you find the IP address of the system? Under the command prompt, you just have to type ipconfig, and you get the IP address of the system, 192.168. This is the IP address. Okay. So we can try whether, see, by default it is connecting with the name itself. If the system name itself is connecting, well and good. If the client system is not able to recognize the SQL Server through the system name, then we have to use the IP address 1.24. Sorry. And click finish. Sorry. I missed the point. It says connectivity failure. I can give 1.64 and it's succeeding. So now the database can even be accessed via the IP address. You can see database server is a IP address. The system's IP address should be static. It should not be dynamic. With every system start, the IP address should not keep changing. It should be static. How do you set that IP address static? Under the network LAN connection properties. Sorry. change adapters option. Under this, you just right click, go to properties. Under properties, you can select IPv4. Again, click properties. And you can give a fixed IP. Currently, my system is on dynamic IP. Every time I restart, the chances of IP being changed is there. IP change, again, it will show you database configuration failure. You'll have to give a fixed IP saying 192.168.1.24. This will remain same. Here you can give 192.168.1.100. And here you can just give 8.8.8 and give OK. So this is how would be the general setting of your system where you'll be fixing up an IP. This is a fixed IP which we are assigning for a system in the network. Once we click OK, the system will be recognizable through that IP. So every time you restart the server, it will still remain 192.168.1.24 and the database will get connected. Now since we have set up that TCP IP port, which you have just seen here, now we have configured a dynamic port for the system. So even after the client system is not able to connect, then you have to use this dynamic port option. After setting this port, we will set this port only by default, 65432. Unless the client has some other firewall settings or something else, then we'll have to change this. But how do we use this port? Even after doing the IP, if it's not working out, then again, you can do one thing is, you can change back to the system name, Dell PC, or whichever is the server name. I'll revert back to Dell PC 2012 and I can give comma 65432. The port is mentioned with a comma. So once I click finish, it is still connecting. If I give some other port number, it might throw an error because it's not available on that port. So once I click OK, now the database connection is Dell PC slash max 2012 comma 65432. Now all the client systems should still be able to access. Client system with this port number at least should be able to access with Windows and antivirus firewall, everything configured. Now, even after this, if the client system is not getting connected to the main server, then you might have to disable Windows firewall or configure certain additional setting in Windows firewall so that it allows all the SQL server this particular port, or you'll have to disable the antivirus also. Disable firewall, antivirus and try connecting, it should work. This is general, almost 99% connectivity of client and server will get issued, get resolved with this step of options. Those 5-6 options only. This generally works. The final TCP IP port, without disabling any firewall antivirus, it will connect, the client systems will get connected to the main server. At the last option only, we will choose to disable the firewall and antivirus, making sure that there's no security issues happening on the client system. And apart from this, we can even make sure that if client is insisting on having firewall and antivirus, then we'll have to find or get the assistance from the hardware guy if there's an external firewall, anything configured. So the same method of this SQL Server TCP IP configuration is even useful for mobile and web access connectivity. So you'll have to open a port in firewall, or not in firewall, in your system router, the internet modem. When you have configured this 65432, there's even a setting through which we can do a port forwarding of any request coming on that modem for 65432 will be connected to this particular system's IP on this particular port of 65432. Basically, it will directly connect to the SQL database. So we'll have a separate video on the port forwarding, but this is an important measure which we are going to do it across all the clients who are having mobile and web access. Application mobile app access means this is a step which has to be followed foremost. After this step, we have to do one more step through which the mobile access or the database connectivity will be available over internet. All clear? So we have learned about Management Studio, how to change passwords, how to attach, detach, backup, restore, and we have even understood certain command prompts on finding local DB instance names, how to create, stop or delete instances, how to configure local DB, how to find IP address of a system, how to configure a fixed IP for a system, database connectivity failure options where we are enabling the services first in the SQL Server Configuration Manager, and then we are accessing the client system through IP address, through port forwarding options, through SQL Server Firewall BAT file, which we are going to generate, and at last, if anything is not working, then Windows Firewall and Antivirus will be touching this. We'll be disabling those. So that's all. So with this session of SQL Server, and come back with your queries if you have any. Thanks a lot.